All right, number 13, what we have here, the technical term for it is two conjugates that are multiplied together. Conjugates are binomials, right, two terms, and the only difference between the two of them is this one has a positive in the middle and this one has a negative. When you multiply conjugates, it has a nice little pattern. To see the pattern, we'll do it the long way, and then utilize the pattern, or you can just keep doing it the long way, either way you like. So the long way would look like 2x times 2x, which is 4x squared. Okay? Use x times x is x squared. 2x times negative 1, negative 2x. Here's the interesting part. You get a positive 2x as well. When you multiply conjugates, you go in the middle, you always get a positive and a negative of the same term, and they cancel each other out. 1 times negative 1. So we just get 4x squared minus 1, which is the square of this. Square of 2 is 4, square of x is x squared. And square of 1, which is 1. So the square of the first minus the square of the second. Why?
What?
Do you have a question?
Oh, I already fixed my problem.
Okay. So if you want to use that, she's like, hey, look at that. There's two binomials. The middle sign is the only difference here. One's positive, one's negative. Okay. I know that they're going to cancel each other out in the middle, so I can just take the square of the first minus the square of the second. The square of this is 4x squared, the square of this is 1, and I subtract them. So what does it mean to square something? What's that?
Parentheses, you
parentheses times identical parentheses.
Yeah.
Just like square always means multiply that thing by exactly the same thing.
Multiply that thing by the thing with the other thing.
Exactly. But not the other thing, that's too many.
Minus that one thing.
Thing by the thing, well, actually divided by the thing.
Is this not?
No, it's not.
Oh.
Because it was under
there.
Barely looking here by any chance,
because
I can't find it.
I
don't know.
Do
you know a number
you
have?
No.
I have
a couple there.
This belongs to you.
Huh?
Shall I?
Not
mine.
Sarah Huffgrass.
That's mine.
Okay, so when are we going to multiply these together? Jason?
Yes.
What?
Yes.
Okay. 6x times 6x is
36x squared.
Never mind.
What?
36x squared.
Yes, 36x squared. 6x times 5 is
36x. Oh, I got this.
6x times 5.
30x.
30x. 5 times 6x is also
30x.
So, I wouldn't say this is the exact opposite of what we just did, because the word opposite is pretty inflammatory, a lot of controversy there. But this, we wound up with two opposites, and they cancel each other out. Here we wound up with two of the exact same thing, and so it like doubles. So we get 36x squared plus 60x plus 45. If you happen to notice you're multiplying two identical binomials together, you can use the pattern of the first thing squared plus this times that times 2, right? Times 2 because there's two of them, plus the square of this guy. Or maybe that's just kind of a clunky pattern to notice and use and just multiply them together, combine like terms, and you'll be fine. Jason?
Okay. So that's 30x. And that's 30x.
Yeah.
You add them together equals 60x.
Are you thinking it's 60x squared?
Yes.
Okay, let's go over that again.
No. Wait, no, I understand 60x.
You
I understand.
Think it's squared if you're dividing.
Only when you're multiplying, because then by definition, an x times an x is an x times itself, which is what squared means.
Yeah.
The shorthand is squared. But when you add them, we're just collecting them like one Mountain Dew plus two Mountain Dews is three Mountain Dews. Not three Mountain Dew squares.
My Mountain Dew.
You
understand?
Yeah,
I don't know how you square a Mountain Dew. It's already in three dimensions. It's quite.
How do you get a square?
Okay.
Yankee in welding.
Any questions?
I don't know.
Continue.
There's no questions, then I'm gonna, well, continue means I'm gonna give you a homework review. You wanna see.
Okay.
You can multiply binomials together, multiply polynomials together. If you can show your work and it makes sense, it's all right answer, then I'm cool with it. Homework review, yeah. Take out a piece of paper. Everybody please, take out a piece of paper. Put other things away. So the first one, let's go ahead and work it out the good old dependable tried and true way. Multiply the parentheses by itself. The square means multiply the thing by itself. The thing that we're supposed to multiply by itself is the whole parentheses, as Carson explained earlier. So x times x gives us x squared. X times 12 gives us 12x. 12 times x gives us 12x. And 12 times 12.
144.
X squared. We combine these like terms. 24x. And that's here we have, again, two conjugates, things that almost look identical, except the middle sign is opposite, plus 4, minus 4. Okay. I know, it seems such second nature after all these times multiplying conjugates together. I know I'm going to get x squared, that's the square of x, and minus 16, which is the square of 4. We're not sure, we can always just multiply it out. No problem there, x squared. Negative 4x. Positive 4x, there's why we don't have an x term here. 4 times negative 4 is negative 16. These guys cancel each other out. X squared minus 16. Right. Here, nothing nice, no patterns or anything to use. Just multiply, combine like terms if there are any, and there you have it. 2x times 4x is what?
8x squared.
2x times 5.
10x.
Plus 10x. Negative 3 times 4x.
Negative
12x. Negative 3 times 5.
Negative 15.
These are like terms. So we in the middle will have negative 2x. So 8x squared minus 2x minus 1.
Wow.
This is the first time.
All right. Definitely should have your notes out during that time, taking notes on that, compare it to your work when you get it back, as soon as I can get it to you. If you didn't already have your notes out, make sure you have your notes out. Those were there for our convenience, but I don't think all right, so make sure you have your notes out. I'll give you a few minutes. All right, I'm going to write something up here. I want you to think about it for a second. I don't want you to shout it out. I want everybody to think for themselves for just a minute. Okay. Let's say I take some number a, right? Just a variable, could be anything. I'm going to multiply that by some number b. Again, b could be anything, any number. B is a variable. We're familiar with this in algebra, right?
N equals c.
Huh?
A equals c.
No.
Oh.
It could, but it doesn't. In this case, it equals, and it's very important that it equals this. It's very handy, actually. Zero. So don't say anything. I want you to think about this equation. There's not a lot going on. There's not a lot of information. But I want you to draw a conclusion that 100% has to be true. 100% has to be true. Think of it to yourself. Think of how to phrase this conclusion clearly, succinctly. I know absolutely 100% sure that this has to be true because so let me give you some situations and some conclusions that seem like they would be true, but they don't necessarily have to be true. We want something that does necessarily, absolutely, 100% have to be true. So like, let's look up here. There's some orange writing on the board, right? So if I were to say, well, then I must have used this marker to write on the board. Does it necessarily have to be true?
No.
Why not?
No, because you got that orange marker and that orange
marker.
Here's
an orange marker. Maybe I use this one. Or maybe I use this one. Okay, so then could I say, well, then I must have used one of these three markers to write on this board.
Well,
let's assume these are the only orange markers in the entire world.
Yes.
Can we say that for sure? That I must have written these on the board with these one of these orange markers?
Yes.
Nobody could think of any alternate scenario?
Someone else
wrote it. I didn't write it. Somebody else wrote it with... Okay, so maybe we could say, if these were the only orange markers in the world, some sentient being wrote with one of these three markers on this board. I think that's pretty for sure.
No.
You see what I'm saying?
Because it could be a creature.
I said a sentient being.
Oh.
Chewbacca did it.
Got it.
Chewbacca.
Okay. You see what I'm saying? Like, if there's some kind of an alternate scenario, then we haven't quite gotten to the 100% it has to be this way. So let me ask you this. Does it have to be that 0 times 0 equals 0?
No, it could be like 12 times 0.
Could be 12 times 0.
Infinity times 0.
Ooh, boy.
That's one word.
Really?
I said like
1
divided
zero.
By
0
equals B.
Trust. Not necessary.
That's what math taught me my whole life.
A divided by 0 equals B.
A divided by 0 equals B.
If that is true, then yes, it does, Wyatt.
Well, what? If I wanted to solve for B, wouldn't I have to divide both sides by A?
Don't get sticky with me when I'm trying to do math.
So 0 divided by A equals B.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Oh, I thought you said A divided by 0.
No, B divided by
2. So we can't just flip things around in division and call it the same. Like, 1 divided by 2 is not the same as 2 divided by 1.
No.
0 divided by A is not the same as A divided by 0. But what is 0 divided by A?
B. Like what?
Well, what's zero? 0 divided by anything?
Zero.
Zero. So B has to be zero.
So that's correct.
According to that logic. Does that mean that A has to be zero?
Dude, what? I really want to get into a fight. Go to the office.
Hey, let's just chill out. Stop talking to her.
I didn't. Seriously? I didn't say anything. She like pulled the tin on me.
Hey. Stop. First, stop talking, and second, stop saying things like that.
Yeah.
Okay, we're kind of getting to it. Does B have to be the one zero?
No.
No.
What else could it be?
A could be zero.
Zero. But does one of them have to be zero?
No.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Yes. No. Yeah. Because
you could
say,
at least one of them have to be zero?
It could be, but you could do like something like 12 divided by something else or
multiply.
Yes.
Yes. 12 times what would be zero?
Zero. Anything
zero.
Times zero is zero. So they have both have to be
one
of them.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's see if we all agree on this statement. I'm going to use some algebra here. So if this, then A is zero or B is zero. We all agree on that?
Yes.
Nobody disagrees? Do they both have to be zero?
No.
Could
they could be. But do they have to be?
No.
So that's why we use this word or. Like, either this or that. This has to be true, or this has to be true. They could both be zero, that's fine. Because that would still satisfy that. But if neither one of them is zero, then it would be impossible for us to get zero when we multiply, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we're talking about. And that's a really handy truth to use. This is called the zero product property. Why is it called zero? Like, why is the word zero used?
Zero's implied.
Zero's what it's equal to, right? Mm-hmm. Implying one of them is zero. Why is it called product?
Because whatever you have to use division to figure it out.
Product is the result of
result.
Of multiplication, right? So we multiply, we got the product. The product was zero. Mm-hmm. Zero is the product. The property is one of them has to be zero. Jason?
I know. A times parenthesis B and parenthesis equals zero.
What does that do?
Because it's stuff.
It's stuff. I'm not sure what stuff means, but
I don't know. I just feel like it does something.
Well, parentheses like that just means multiply.
Yes.
Well, here, let me start you off on this. So we know that if two things are multiplied together, we get zero. One of the two things that we multiplied by has to be zero. Okay. And I'm stressing this because it's not the same as to say, oh, well, anything times zero is zero. That's true. But it's stronger to say that one of these has to be zero. It's stronger than saying like, oh, that needs to be times zero. But what we're saying is the only way to get zero by multiplying is to multiply by zero. Okay. Since we know that's the truth, let's say we take 2x plus 3.
It's not doing it.
Let's make it way easier than that. Let's make it x plus 1.
X plus 4.
X squared plus 3x plus 2 equals 0. First, I want you to just think, like, what is x? Try to figure out what x is.
0.
Can't be.
If you have a guess, plug it in, see if it works. Okay? All right, since we have now one thing times a second thing,
What?
Have a seat.
Because
either this parentheses is zero, right? Like, I plug something in for x and this comes out to be zero, so zero times, it doesn't even matter what that is, equals zero. Or some other number I plug into this parentheses, this winds up being zero times whatever that is zero.
Okay.
So you're wanting us to plug in zero for x and do the work for that one?
No, not plug in zero for x. Figure out
x
what to plug in for x.
That
probably
equals
not
zero.
That this equals zero, the whole parentheses equals zero, or this equals zero.
Both.
Either one. Both.
Wow.
Like, yeah.
Okay.
Both.
So you can use whatever one.
If this is equal to, so I'll write this down. If this stuff in this parentheses comes out to be zero, like if x is such,
then that's the.
That this comes out to be zero. Then we'll get zero because we're going to multiply that zero here by this number, whatever this number comes out to be. And, well, it doesn't matter what that number is because zero times anything is zero, right? So what would it take, you know, what x would we need for this parentheses to come out zero? What would you have to plug in right there for this to come out zero?
Zero.
If I plug in zero, zero minus two, negative two.
Oh, plus two, sorry.
A positive two, two minus two is zero, right? Which we'll also find if we solve this equation. Add 2 to both sides, x is 2. Starting to get it?
Yes.
Does that make some more sense? Okay, if not, watch this next one. Let me show you why x equals 2 is a solution to this equation. Watch this, we'll test it out. Plug in 2 for x. 2 minus 2, right, that's the left parentheses. The right parentheses would look like 2 times 2 plus 3 equals 0. 2 minus 2 is 0, right, that's this parentheses. Times is going to multiply by this. This is 4 plus 3, that's 7.
And then 0 times 7 equals 0.
0 times 7 equals 0.
Oh, right.
You get that sign next time?
I signed it.
Oh, okay. 0 times 7 is 0. Right? Is that right? Is that true?
Yes.
Yeah, so let's back up. It must be that if x equals 2, then, well, we make the equation true, but 0 does equal 0. 0 times 7 is 0. Right? Or no?
Yes.
Okay. So, let's just say that. If x equals 2, plug 2 in for this equation, right? In for x in this equation. Plug it in there. 2 minus 2 is 0. We plug in 2 there, 2 times 2 plus 3, 2 times 2 plus 3, 4 plus 3 is 7, and 0 times 7 equals 0. And that's true. Okay. To find the other thing, the other value we can plug in for x, it would be a value for x that we plug in here that causes this parenthesis to be 0. So this parenthesis, if it came out to be 0, if all of this, or whatever I plug in for x comes out to be 0, then I'll have 0 times this number is 0. And the equation would be true, and we have the solution. subtract 3 from both sides. 2x equals negative 3, divide by 2. X equals negative 3 halves.
So then, would you say that's like the right answer?
They're both valid answers. Either this will make the equation equal, will make the side 0, or this will make it 0. I'll show you that that's true for that negative 3 halves. Okay, so we'll plug in negative 3 halves into the equation. That's x minus 2 times 2x plus 3. If I plug in negative 3 halves into this equation, I get negative 3 halves minus 2. 2 times negative 3 halves plus 3 equals 0. Okay? I'm not even going to worry about this. This is a mess. Okay? But it's some number, right? Agreed? If we put those together, it'll be some number. So I'll just write this again, negative 3 halves minus 2. What happens over here is more interesting. 2 divides 2. This is this 1 times negative 3. 1 times negative 3 is negative 3. Plus 3. What's negative 3 plus 3? It's just 0, right? And 0 times, it doesn't even matter what this is, because 0 times 0 is what?
0.
0. So we did, we found it. Negative 3 halves is a solution because it makes the left side equal to 0. Positive 2 also works because it makes the whole thing come out to be 0. Using that 0 product line. If we make this be 0, 0 times anything is 0. Or if we make this 0, 0 times anything is 0. So those values of x that make that happen, those are the solutions. Let's try another one. X minus 5 times 3x minus 8 equals 0. So you can make it a little farther on this one on your own without my help than you did the last. Place to start. You said, okay, so here's what I'm thinking. If this comes out to be 0, then 0 times whatever the right parentheses is will be 0. Right? So you say, if I put a 5 here, right, it's all going to work out. You know what I mean? I saw this on several people's papers. Right?
Yes.
Okay. And okay, so then this would be 5 as well, 3 times 5.
3 plus 15, and then so minus
0
8
times 7.
Plus 7, and 7 times 0 is 0.
And so, what did we figure out there? We haven't really made a conclusion about x. What would x have to be?
X would have to be 5.
So we've got to say that. Okay. So x equals 5, that's one solution. But that's only one of two solutions.
Do we have to do the other solution?
Of course. Gotta find the other solution because this parentheses could be 0, but alternately, the right parentheses could be 0. Right?
I know.
This whole mess here could come out to be 0. We'll figure out what is it that we have to go in for x for that mess to come out to be 0. Well, this stuff could result in a 0, and we know that we wind up multiplying by a 0, and of course we get 0. So, we add 8 to both sides, 3x equals 8, we divide by 3, and x is 8/3. I wouldn't put this as a decimal because you'd have to round that decimal and it would be not accurate. 8/3 is accurate. 2.6 is not accurate. 2.7 is not accurate. 2.67 is not accurate. At some point you have to round off that infinite decimal and, well, we don't want to do that. So leave it as a fraction for sure. If you have to round to write that answer down, don't write it down. Because if I plug in 2.6 or 2.67 or 2.8, it doesn't matter. It's never going to come out to be exactly. Plug in 8/3, 3 cancels with that 3. 8 minus 8 is 0. 0 times anything is 0. Okay? Okay. Like you guys are getting it. Let's try 3x plus. I already did a 3 and an 8.
8 and 9.
No.
10.
3x plus 11.
Dang it.
Times 7x minus 12.
Ooh.
Two solutions, two fraction solutions. We got one, two things being multiplied together. Okay? Goes all the way back to what we started with today. A times B equals 0 means either A is 0 or B is 0.
Or both.
Or both. Okay. In this case, we won't get both. I'll show you one more both. But this one, not both. That won't happen.
Only one or the other.
Okay. So one or the other could be zero. If this parentheses is zero, then all that zero times whatever this is going to be zero. So we know that that's going to work. If this guy is zero, then zero times whatever this stuff is definitely going to be zero. So we set up both of those possibilities. One possibility is that, again, you should at least be writing down exactly what I'm writing down. 3x plus 11 equals 0, so we just figure out what x is. So how do we solve for x in that equation?
Okay, so u minus 11.
Yes.
Then go to the other side, and that should equal 11. And then what you do is you divide 3 by 11.
Nope.
And we'll divide, 3
no,
over 11 or whatever. And then you equal negative 11 over 3.
Okay.
And with the other one, you do the same thing, which is 7 x minus 12. You add 12 to 0.
So you add 12 to both sides of the equation.
Yes, and that's when you get 7x equals 12, and that's when you divide 12 to on both sides, 7 on both
seven
sides.
On both sides, yeah.
And that's when you get 12 over 7.
There.
Oh, no.
Shelby, help me understand fractions.
Nice. Good.
Sure. I understand from this.
So we add, divided by 7. We found both of the solutions. If we were to plug them both in, we would find that negative 11/3 turns this parenthesis into a 0, because the 3 would be divided by 3. Negative 11 plus 11 would be 0, and that would work.
Yes.
If you plugged in 12 sevenths right there, the 7 would be divided by the 7, would be left with 12 minus 12, and that would be 0. And it doesn't really matter, if I plug in, I would technically have to plug 12 sevenths in there, but I don't even have to worry about it, because it's going to be multiplied by 0. Right? Now, I said I would show Jason one where both of them are equal to 0. How about this one? X plus 3 times x plus
3.
How many solutions does this have?
That's the same thing.
What? Yeah, they both have the same
solution,
right? Yeah, one solution, or the two solutions are the same solution. Or one solution twice, or negative 3 for this one, negative 3 for this one, right? So there's your, this one is 0, or this one is 0, or both. In that case, both would be 0.
X equals -3.
Yes. X equals -3. One last thing. If we had x plus 2 times x minus 4 equals, pay attention, equals 7, what could we do?
Then either A or B.
Plug in
is that true?
0 for x.
How would
that
go to 7?
So plug in 0 for x, is
it? Yes.
So plug in 0 for x, I'll just get 0, 0 there. So 2 is left here, negative 4. 2 times negative 4 is negative 8. So I know 0 is not a solution. What you're doing is just kind of guessing what solution
yes.
might be.
What are we doing?
Huh?
Teach me. I'm lost.
For now, we would say there's not much I can do here. I can't use the zero product property, right? Because it needs to be equal to 0. The only number that works for this approach is 0. Something times something equals 7 tells me nothing about those numbers. Think about, just think about it as two numbers. A times B equals 7. Is there anything you could say about these numbers?
No.
1 has to be 7 or 1 or...
Could be 7 and 1, but does it have to be 7? No.
Yes, because it's prime.
What? Yes. What about 2 times 3.5?
Well, I was thinking whole numbers here.
Okay. Well, what about negative 1 times negative
7? No.
Negative 1 times negative 7.
You could always just subtract B.
Well, when we have one, just one equation all by itself and it has two variables, we're not going to be able to figure out what it is. The only thing that will help me. If this 0, it has to be equal to 0. It's equal to 7 or equal to 4, anything other than 0. There's absolutely nothing we could say about this. Okay?
Yeah, that's about that, and that's what we know.
So what do we do?
We tap out.
No, we don't do that. We'll just save it for another day. I will not spend time explaining that. I will let you continue on to your homework for now.